Thank you very much. Mr. Billingsley, I want to talk with you a little bit about the service you've been providing at Treasury. And you and I had a long and, I think, productive conversation in my office on these topics just a few days ago. By all accounts, you've excelled in the position you're currently serving in. Nonetheless, as you know, I have some concerns about policy that I'd like to discuss. First of all, regarding Iran. As you know, the Europeans are currently engaged in efforts to circumvent our sanctions against the Ayatollahs, including through a range of initiatives. One of those initiatives is the so-called special purpose vehicle. I am deeply concerned about this vehicle, and I believe it would badly undermine our campaign of maximum pressure. Could you please give me your assessment of the effect you think the vehicle would have on our maximum pressure campaign?
Senator, I share your concern about the so-called INSTEX vehicle, which is the special purpose vehicle. Ostensibly, that vehicle is intended, we're told, is intended to allow for the furnishing of humanitarian assistance. It's not clear to me why that's required, because the Department of the Treasury has never impeded or otherwise objected to humanitarian assistance and medical provision of medical support anywhere in the world. So they seem to be developing it perhaps for other purposes. We've made incredibly clear to the European countries involved that we're following INSTEX very closely, and we will not allow it to be used to circumvent United States sanctions or the maximum pressure campaign we have on Iran.
I want to also dig a little deeper in the issue with another initiative the Europeans are proposing, and specifically the French are proposing extending a $15 billion credit line to the Ayatollahs. What effect do you think providing a $15 billion credit line would have on our pressure campaign?
Senator, I think that would be very counterproductive, and the Secretary of the Treasury has made clear that this is not something we support.
I'm glad to hear it. Let's shift to another part of the world. As you know, I'm also concerned about Russia's construction of the Nord Stream 2 pipeline, which would go to Germany and give Putin much greater control over Europe's energy security. Can you please give me your assessment of what the completion of the Nord Stream 2 pipeline would do to our national security and to Europe's security?
Senator, the president has made clear that he opposes the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. Likewise, Secretary Pompeo and Secretary Mnuchin have both been clear with their counterparts that we think this is an unwise development. There have been representations made to us about how the Ukrainians will be shielded from the development of a whole new pathway that, frankly, I think would allow Russia to bypass Ukraine and deny Ukraine the revenue that they currently generate from the existing pipeline structure. And I think that gives us great pause as well. But ultimately, if your question is going to be whether we feel that disrupting Nord Stream 2 through the application of sanctions, at the moment, that's the perspective of the United States government, is that that's not the right way to address it. And we on the Treasury side, speaking in my Treasury capacity, are working with the Department of State to ensure that the diplomatic channels are maximized in an effort to prevent this pipeline from coming online.
When you say it's the administration's view that sanctions are not the right way to address it, why is that?
Those sanctions authorities, first of all, don't reside with the Treasury Department, so I haven't been privy to the internal deliberations within the State Department on it. But at this stage, I think our goal is to attempt to work through other ways of disrupting the pipeline with European allies, including passage through various territorial waters.
Let me shift to another topic. During the Obama administration, I was very concerned that the Bureau of Counterterrorism and Countering Violent Extremism was downplaying the threat posed by radical Islamic terrorists. The effort even included a euphemistic name change of the Bureau itself to de-emphasize its traditional role in counterterrorism. If confirmed, what steps will you take to ensure that the Bureau returns to its original mission and intent?
Senator, I'll need to look into this with Ambassador Sales and understand how he is thinking about reorganization of the mission. But I think it's very, very important that we provide clarity on the swim lanes that exist within the different Department of State bureaus. And if confirmed, you have my commitment that I'll look into this and get back to you.
I look forward to working with you on it. Final question. Many of us are deeply horrified by the Chinese persecution against the Uyghur minorities. Religious liberty will be within your portfolio if you are confirmed. The Chinese have created a 1984 dystopia where they track the movement of millions of people using cutting-edge biotechnology and artificial intelligence. I've introduced legislation to prevent exports and re-exports of U.S. goods to the companies that are aiding China in this persecution. Could you please describe both the Chinese campaign and how you intend to counter it should you be confirmed?
Senator, as I mentioned in my opening statement, the idea that China could be doing to the Uyghur population in Xinjiang today what they're doing in this day and age is, it's outrageous, it's reprehensible. We are, and I am personally alarmed by the repressive campaign. As you mentioned, it's not just the cruel and inhumane treatment. It is the pervasive high-tech and arbitrary surveillance of the population. But it goes beyond that. It also involves the insertion of ethnic Han Chinese into the houses, into the families of Uyghurs, some of whom's heads of household are imprisoned in these camps. And Chinese claims that these are humane job training centers is an outright falsehood, and it's belied by a wide range of evidence. In these camps, China is trying to force the Uyghurs to renounce their ethnic identity, their religious beliefs, and their religious practices. And this is unacceptable. They have to be held to account, and we have to decry this behavior in every shape, in form and fashion.
Thank you.